This family is heading up the Ebongi River towards Ite, one of the villages on the riverbank opposite in Congo Brazza. They're from the Democratic Republic of Congo. When fighting broke out in the town of Dongo, they fled and sought refuge on a nearby island, an island still in the DRC. But they've just been warned of further turmoil to come.
The situation is becoming quite urgent, with refugees flooding in from all over. We started with 20,000 people. We thought it would be a small project, but now it's exploding. There are 60,000 refugees along the stretch of the river, and more continue to arrive. We fully expect to reach 100,000 very soon.
It's difficult to reach all the refugees in this river-dense region. Small, sometimes isolated groups are scattered along a 150-kilometer stretch. The MSF team crisscrosses the river to follow their movements. Villages have seen their population more than double since the refugees started to arrive. They need aid.
I want to talk to you. We need plastic sheeting. I don't have a man here to build a shelter for us. Let me speak. Here I am. I have no news from my husband. My children are not here. I am alone. We are suffering here. It's raining and we're out here in the open. We can't take this any longer. I don't have enough to eat. Look at me, how I look. I have no more clothes.
They need food, shelter and water, as many drink straight from the river and fall ill. MSF has set up mobile clinics to reach the most isolated people, including those here on Mumbata Island.
We landed in an unfamiliar environment, and as soon as we arrived, we discovered that people have major health needs. If we hadn't come, the people here today would not have been able to reach a health center. They are isolated on an island, and it's difficult to reach the other riverbank on the Republic of Congo side.
The team saw 65 patients in 3 hours. Most of them suffering from diarrhea, respiratory infection or malaria. Medical consultations are carried out at 4 sites, Ebuku, Lanza, Boyele and in the town of Betu, where the population has quadrupled since the refugees arrived. Some are being sheltered at a school, some here in the buildings of this abandoned factory. Others are living with families. More refugees arrive every day. Some travelling as far as the border with the Central African Republic. On the other side of the river, in DRC, an MSF team is trying to provide assistance to a population of approximately 40,000 displaced civilians who find themselves without any aid. The level of violence in southern Sudan has been increasing since December 2008, particularly in Jonglei, Lake and Upper Nile states. It is no longer simply a matter of frequent disputes over livestock theft.
We were sleeping, and then we heard gunshots and ran out of the house towards the river. When we arrived at the river, they saw us and started shooting. Some of us were killed. I was lucky.
Nearly 87% of patients treated by MSF in Jonglei and Upper Nile states presented gunshot wounds.
Instead of having the attacks targeting the cattle, the resources, instead of cattle raids like in the past that involve minor numbers of people, now we have attacks against the towns and the villages. The population is directly affected. We have elder people, we have women and children that are targeted, abduction of children, and we have even more dead people than wounded people at the moment.
5 years after the North-South Agreement ending the war, the humanitarian and medical situation is critical. This year, MSF, working in 7 southern Sudan states, has increased its activities. More than 360,000 patient consultations were carried out in October, 50,000 more than October last year. Over the past year, the situation has changed in Kivu, in eastern DRC. However, the level of violence remains very high and the populations continue to live amidst insecurity.
They told us there was peace in our village, Kivuya. I went to Kivuya where I had a field of sweet potatoes. I was at home, ready to sleep. Horrible men came with machetes and knives. I was there with two kids. The others were still in the camp. They separated us and I couldn't escape. A man knocked me down.
Last year, there were violent clashes between the Congolese army and the CNDP, the National Congress for the People's Defense, led by Laurent Nkunda. The populations fled heavy fighting, only to be faced with further armed conflict. Over the last few months, attempts have been made to track down FDLR rebels. This conflict resembles guerrilla warfare.
With everything that's going on, we are dealing with hundreds of thousands of displaced persons. People are fleeing the conflict, trying to find refuge wherever they can, with host families or in camps that they set up themselves. They use branches and banana leaves to create shelters. Of course, as in any situation involving displacement, people are exposed to illnesses, like respiratory infections in the higher elevations and malaria in the lower elevation regions.
A year ago, MSF created the website Condition Critical to focus attention on the violence affecting the populations in eastern Congo. The latest dossier concentrates on wounds. After considerable media attention surrounding the conflict last year, the crisis in the region has moved out of public view.
The media are right there when the conflict is acute, when it peaks. They all show up. They cover the situation temporarily, and then the discussion ends. And people don't realize what's happening to the populations in eastern Congo. They aren't aware of daily life there, the suffering these people have endured for years in the course of this ongoing conflict. MSF wanted to emphasize that. We wanted to give a voice indirectly to the populations.
The victims, both men and women, speak of the physical and psychological violence they have suffered.
That camp, no for people, that for animals, okay? You understand?
These Iraqis have been held here for 4 months in the Vena Detention Center in Rhodope in northern Greece. Having fled their homeland, an ever-growing number of asylum seekers are arriving in Greece. In 2008, more than 44,000 were arrested when they crossed the Turkish border. Under Greek law, they can be held in detention for 1 year. The risks for those seeking exile are increasing as tougher immigration policies are implemented.
As a result of these policies, people have to take higher risks to come to Europe, for example. We hear accounts in Malta of people who traveled for 3 weeks through the desert with very little water, very little food, with dehydration as a result. More people have to take smaller boats to come to Malta or Italy. There are more people who die during this journey.
Those who manage to reach Europe arrive physically and emotionally exhausted. Access to healthcare is very limited. Their living conditions are appalling. They have no access to psychological support, and the women and unaccompanied minors are unable to receive appropriate care. When they arrive, instead of finding refuge, they find exclusion. MSF also works in Malta, a gateway to Europe, to France, Belgium and Italy. The teams provide treatment for physical and psychological conditions to these refugees traumatized by their journey to exile.
When we got to Gardales, we just had a bit to eat, a few biscuits. We saw some men come towards us. We need women, they said. Why do you need women, we said. We need women. They started beating us. They were very strong, very strong. I was raped over 5 days, 5 days, 5 days.
On the eve of International Migrants Day, MSF urges policymakers across Europe to respect the dignity of undocumented migrants and asylum seekers and to improve their access to healthcare and shelter. 7 million HIV-positive people in developing countries are in need of life-saving treatment. Although medical progress in AIDS has been made, it is not reaching patients, largely due to patents.
A huge amount of research has been conducted in the field of AIDS, and new drugs are constantly appearing on the market. They are available to patients in the north, but are much too expensive for patients in the south, because they are protected by patents. As a result, in the countries we work in, we don't have access to the drugs we'd like to use to treat our patients.
Patent pools could improve access to these drugs. UNITAID, an international drug purchasing facility, supports this principle.
There is a solution. Here's how a patent pool could work. Companies give their HIV patents to an independent organization called a patent pool. The pool then acts like a one-stop patent shop. Companies and researchers can access patents in exchange for a fair royalty payment to the inventors.
This would mean that the pharmaceutical companies would grant their patents on a voluntary basis to a patent pool. Of course, they would be compensated for doing so, for the sale of these products in generic form. They would still receive royalties. So there would be a mechanism for compensating the pharmaceutical companies for drugs that anyway are being sold in places where the companies aren't even present.
MSF has launched a mobilization campaign to encourage 9 international drug companies that produce antiretroviral drugs to share their patents. Nearly 270,000 emails have already been sent. UNITAID's board of directors gathered on December the 14th and 15th to deal with the key issue of launching a patent pool. MSF insists that the middle-income countries, such as India, Thailand, South Africa and China, must be able to benefit from this mechanism too.